Across Britain, thousands of historic buildings have been neglected. Their owners struggling to restore them because of planning restrictions, design problems, or lack of money.
Luckily, some romantics do take on the challenge of converting and restoring these forgotten gems.
But it isn't for the faint-hearted.
It's sat here and it's falling apart.
I think it can push you to the limit, actually.
We have to find a way of getting this done, because if we don't, then we lose everything.
They're often churches, mills and barns.
But also factories, warehouses and industrial buildings that are often abandoned because they're so difficult for residential conversion. These buildings have as much rich history and tell as many fascinating stories about our past as any stately home or medieval castle.
These are palaces of industry, and so it's such a privilege to live in one.
As an architect, I relish the challenge that these unusual buildings give us when we're trying to create a place called home.
This time, a couple of serial restorers meet their match.
Oh, I know it looks pretty horrific to some people, but...
It is!
But they couldn't have imagined the problems that this 18th century flint mill had in store for them.
I don't know what I did in a previous life, but obviously this one's not running quite to plan.
At the foot of the picturesque Modishaw Valley in Staffordshire is the historic town of Stone. Not far from the Victorian town centre, sheltered by the railway embankment, is a pocket of older buildings dating from the 18th century. Most visitors to this spot head for the restaurant in the restored corn mill. But for Alan Appleby and his wife Dora, it was the dilapidated old flint mill next door that caught their eye. Alan is a professional building surveyor who's also a seasoned restorer. He and Dora have already restored and lived in three listed properties. They both have family connections in Stone, and now that their children have grown up and left home, they're keen to settle here and throw themselves into one final project.
Dora and I were out looking for property, and we drove down through the railway bridge, and this poor old building was sitting here, covered in ivy and cracks. I turned to her and I said, we could do something with that.
This one is special to me because it's never been a home, so it's going to be quite different.
It's exciting to me as a surveyor and a serial renovator of buildings that I think, whoa, this is a good one. And we've got one left in us.
They paid £100,000 for the Grade 2 listed mill, bought with their savings. They've estimated the work will take a year and have a budget of £175,000, which will be financed by the sale of their current home. They then plan to rent locally until the mill is complete.
The one I've got to be really, really careful about is the money. Mm. Everything can be solved with another wadge of cash, and we haven't got endless wadges of cash.
However experienced they are, it's still easy to run into trouble on a difficult project like this. So I hope I can lend a helping hand.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you, Alan.
Nice
how are you?
To see you.
Hi, Dora.
Hi,
how are
George.
You? You well?
I'm fine, thank you. Yes.
It's amazing, this. And like, other side of that railway bridge, you feel like you're in 21st century commercial supermarket land. And then as soon as you come through the archway, you've gone back in time. It's like a little hidden world.
Absolutely.
It is.
Absolutely.
It is.
And this particular piece of land has been kept in private ownership for many, many years, so it's just never got redeveloped. And that's how it's ended up with this strange little nook right so close to the town centre.
Shall we just step back and have a look
at
it, so you can see the scale of what you've taken on here, because it's knackered, isn't it?
It has some issues.
You've got enormous crack. I mean, there's cracks everywhere, to be honest, but that is a big old chunky one. I mean, that crack's got to be 2 inches wide at that top part,
George,
all the way down that
bit.
You're
worried too much.
But it's quite ambitious, isn't it? Really?
Mm,
I mean, it is a wreck. I'd love to know what your surveyor's report said. I'd love to know that. You didn't bother, did you?
No.
You didn't do one. It's so knackered, it wasn't worth doing a survey.
It all comes from here. It all comes from here. It's the gut feeling.
In its current state, the mill is a shadow of its former self. The wheel has gone, and the channel of water that once fed it was filled in long ago. But when it was up and running, the stream would have poured down onto a huge wooden water wheel. This generated the energy to power 15 tons of machinery that ground flint into a fine powder. All that has gone too, and the mill is now one huge open space with a footprint of 400 square feet.
Oh, this is great. It's quite deceiving, because from the outside, I thought it felt like quite a small building. But when you come into it, and you look up, this is an enormous volume, isn't it?
Cavernous sort of space, isn't it?
Very high.
So what do you know about the building?
It seems, from what we can work out, it was purpose-built as a flint grinding mill producing powdered flint for the potteries industry. And if you look carefully up into the walls there, you can see that there are arcs cut into the sides of the four main walls.
Yeah.
And that was to give space for a big rotating grinding pan. But in the 19th and 20th century, it was used as a store, and then later on as a vehicle garage. They chopped a big hole in the front wall to get the lorries in, put a vehicle inspection pit in. Fantastic. Fantastic. If you've got a vehicle garage, you need somewhere to work on your vehicles from underneath.
Brilliant.
That'll do.
So it's literally a maintenance inspection pit.
Yep. Okay. Lid back
lorry
on
would
quick.
Come in for its MOT.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Park in there, and the mechanics would be underneath.
Absolutely.
So I want to go up on this deck. Is that safe to go up?
Upstairs, on what remains of the first floor, you get a closer look at the mill's distinctive round windows.
The circular holes are quite common in the flint mills in this area, and they seem to have been provided for light and ventilation for the grinding pan area, so that you've got something to work with daylight, and you've got ventilation to keep the silica dust out of your lungs as best as possible.
Originally, the mill's wheel would have turned in the open air, but it was prone to freezing up in winter, so it was later enclosed in this lean-to extension.
If you look just behind you, that's the centre hub bearing there. You can imagine that's the middle of the water wheel. And according to the records, it was 22 feet high, so that's 11 up and 11 down. So this was full of water wheel. Water coming straight in over the top of there.
Is that wall collapsing?
Good spot, Mr.
Mr. Surveyor.
Good spot. There is some rotation at eaves level, yes, sir.
And I know it looks pretty horrific to some people, but it is pretty horrific.
Yeah, it is.
Alan and Dora have worked on the design of their new home themselves and got a local architect to draw up their scheme. The building faces south, and the main entrance hall will lead into a central hall where the wheel once stood. The new kitchen and dining area will be on the ground floor, and a new office and toilet in the new extension. On the first floor, there's a sitting room and utility room, and in the extension, a further bedroom and shower room. On the top floor within the roof space is their master bedroom suite, with access to a balcony that will overlook their garden.
The one bit I don't get.
Yes, okay.
I just don't get it, if you don't mind me saying.
No, please.
Is your dressing area and your shower room on the first floor next to the living room?
Well, that's
what's
Alan.
All that about?
I don't like that personally myself.
Yeah, it's my fault.
It's Alan's fault.
It's my fault.
I don't like that at all.
The reason why it doesn't work, I'll tell you what, there's two reasons.
Go on.
The main reason is that why would you have a dressing room and shower room next to your living area anyway, mm-hmm. when you're actually going to physically use it? Because I think there's a privacy issue. And secondly, where's south?
This way. We've got two windows here facing
which
south.
Which way? That way?
Yeah, yeah, straight out the front
which
here.
Which is lovely.
Yeah.
And where you've got all that beautiful natural light and those beautiful windows,
yep.
it's kind of being plugged by your dressing room and shower room.
Okay.
Do you know what it is? You've fallen into that trap, and everybody does it, is that when you've got a space which is beautiful, you know, you walk into it and you go, wow, this is amazing. There's a danger that once you start making it functional and practical, which I know you have to because it's a home, you start to lose the architectural quality of what's there because you start putting in too many rooms, too many boxes, too many walls, too many floors. If Alan and Dora were looking for a challenge, they've certainly found one. And to add to everything else, they've got a major engineering problem on their hands. The mill was built into the side of the hill, and the weight of all that earth is threatening to push the building over. So the whole bank will need to be dug out. This building is absolutely knackered. It's honestly in danger of collapse any day. I don't know whether they're brave or foolhardy. Alan and Dora Appleby are fighting to save a forgotten 18th century flint mill, which is in a derelict state. One wrong move and the whole thing could collapse. The first job is to install a septic tank across the road, over which they're going to build a new garage. But the excavations have thrown up some early problems. The old mains drainage pipe for the mill stopped right under where the garage is going to be, so they've had to extend it by 20 feet.
It's a lot of effort and a lot of money to go to, you know, men here for 10 days instead of 3 days.
Alan and Dora have budgeted £175,000 for the whole restoration. A figure that, to me, always sounded optimistic, even for people with their past restoration experience. It's been 4 months since my first visit, and I'm looking forward to seeing what progress has been made.
Morning!
Good.
How are you?
Morning, George.
Lovely to see you. The building is still standing.
It is a remarkable,
I'm happy to
a remarkable
say,
miracle.
It
yes.
is still here. But looking at that, there is no doubt about it, those cracks are a lot wider than when I was here the first time.
Not only are they wider, they've been joined by another one just about 300 mil to the left of
there.
That vertical.
Yes.
Yeah. So, yes, the building is continuing to move, which is a concern. But we've taken down the bits that were about to fall down.
Right.
And we're keeping a very careful eye on the rest.
Because this building, on a simple level, just needs to be strapped together, doesn't it?
It needs
just
a good belt,
up,
doesn't
yeah,
it, really?
Needs a, yeah,
it
big
needs
belt.
A good belt.
Just tighten it up and yeah. strap it in so it doesn't move again. And you started building your garage?
Yes.
Which
eventually. Eventually. It took us nearly 10,000 quid to get to the floor.
You're joking.
No.
That's £10,000 extra than you'd budgeted for, isn't it?
That's the contingency fund. It's just that it happened at the beginning instead of in the middle or at the end when it feels nice.
Yeah, it's a little bit worrying when the contingency disappears that early.
Correct.
Because you've still got a lot to do on the
move. And we have got a bit more contingency, but we've used up some of that on this hole in the ground as well.
I see.
3 full concrete loads, 24 cubic metres in the ground.
More money again.
More money again. OK, see you in a bit.
But there is some good news. Where they needed to relieve pressure on the back of the building, they started the enormous task of digging out the bank, and they found something really exciting.
And you've uncovered all this?
Yeah, absolutely fantastic. I mean, just to give you an idea, the top of the ground was here, roughly where my head height is now. All this rock was uncovered.
And I'm assuming that this, because of a shape, was funneling the water.
Correct.
Down to the wheel.
Correct.
Which is fabulous, isn't it? What a discovery that is.
Yeah.
That it's still here.
Yep.
It's been sitting under all that muck.
Under all that muck for about 150 years, we think. And there's one more little thing to show you up there.
Come on, let's have a look. You're loving this, aren't you?
Oh, it's fantastic.
You are actually genuinely loving
it. It's fantastic. This here, it's a wall.
Well, they've dug it all out.
And dug it out. We don't know what this pit was for. Here you go.
This is great, isn't it?
Yeah. And that saucepan is exactly where it was.
Which I shouldn't meet on.
But yeah, you can, it's all been recorded.
Look at that, eh?
There's a couple of ideas. One of them was that they used to keep food that they cooked and brought to work warm in a hay box.
They sort of
bury it in, it's right, keeps it warm during the day.
This is real.
It's good fun.
Real history, this.
Good fun.
The mill at Stone has been abandoned and forgotten for almost 50 years, and documents relating to its history are few and far between. But this 1775 map shows us that it was once one of 10 flint mills on a 3-mile stretch of a tributary of the River Trent, known as the Scotch Brook. What I didn't know was the key role these mills played in revolutionising the Staffordshire pottery industry, transforming tea sets and dinner services the world over. I've come to meet retired engineer Barry Lakin, who runs Mosty Lee Mill, 2 miles upstream from Stone.
And that is beautiful. Look at that. Oh, it's like going back in time.
Mosty Lee was the last operational flint grinding mill in the valley. It finally stopped production in 1961.
And this is where all the grinding would happen, yeah?
That's correct, yes.
Even though the mill no longer grinds flint, Barry keeps the machinery and work in order as a reminder of the industry that dominated this area for over 200 years.
So, Barry, why were there so many mills in the Modershaw Valley?
Well, the lie of the land lent itself to it. Scotch Brook flows right through the bottom of the valley, which was ideal for water mills. Equally, as the mills became used for flint grinding eventually, they were not that far away from the potteries where the demand for flint was.
And so why did this, if you like, this kind of burst of activity come around because of flint? Why did we need flint?
Well, we've got some original 18th century pottery here.
I better be very careful with this stuff.
That's basically the colour of pottery before flint was introduced. You know, it was dependent on the colour of the clay. In this area, a lot of it was red, or at the best, grey. They found that if they mixed flint, it helped to make the clay white. Here we have a part of a little later than the same period, but you can see that is generally white or creamy.
What a discovery that was.
Yes.
Incredible, really.
But it wasn't flint in its raw state that had this effect.
Here's a normal flint nodule.
First, it had to be baked in a kiln. The intense heat transformed the flint from being hard and black to brittle and white.
What a difference to go from that. It couldn't be more different, could it?
Not only is it white, it's now in a state that it can be reduced to a powder by crushing or grinding, made the resulting pottery stronger, and it also assisted in the kiln firing of the article in that they didn't lose as many in the kiln.
Obviously, you know, there's lots of other industries in this area, but when flint came along, it must have been like, I don't know.
It made a big difference.
Must have been like the internet boom of the 20th
yes.
century.
Back on site, the garage is up, and so is a boundary wall to give them a bit of privacy from the former corn mill next door. Now they're starting on the blockwork for the new extension, which, when built, will act as a buttress to support the unstable east wall. Inside, the delicate job of bracing this fragile structure is about to begin. Two huge steels, each weighing a quarter of a ton, are being carefully lifted into position and bolted together.
Bring it down. Bring it in. And down. Get back off it. Yeah.
These beams will brace the building and give it some much-needed stability while providing support for the new first floor.
Beautiful. Spot on. The good thing is now that we've started the process of repair. And so it's looking good. It's looking good, and I'm much happier now.
It's 10 months since I first came to the mill, and I'm back to check on progress.
Morning. You all right?
For the first time in years, this derelict building is getting its strength back, and the new extension is giving much needed support.
Morning, anyone home?
Morning.
Good morning.
Hello there, how are
Can
you?
Can you use the doorbell in future?
It looks Amazing. And this is all new. This is a fantastic new opening through here.
Yeah.
And you've got steels in, you've got the first floor beams up there, which look absolutely brilliant. It's looking really good, isn't it?
Yeah.
You happy?
It's come back together. It's all in one piece.
And the garage looks good. It's a nice little timber-framed shed.
It gives the illusion of being timber-framed. It's actually a block construction.
Is it?
Solid block construction with insulation and weatherboarding outside, that being the construction design for the extension. So the extension will look similar.
See, my only worry about that is it looks so good and so comfortable. The boys are just hanging out in it all day. Look at them sitting there doing their cups of tea. They'll never come out. It is very smart, though. It's really, really nice.
It is nice.
Can we go upstairs?
I'm keen to know if they've taken my advice and removed that unnecessary shower room that was ruining their living room.
This is the first time I've been up here. I haven't been up here.
The first time? What do you think?
I think it's brilliant.
And I'm so glad that shower room wasn't in here.
You've changed it all. Woohoo! You got rid of your shower room.
It's gone.
Yes.
So this is... the nice sitting, space.
Lovely, sitting, lovely yeah. sitting room.
Proper yeah. open plan space yeah. without a little shower tucked in the yeah. corner. Been walking out with a little towel wrapped around them, you know, semi-naked with guests around.
It's never going to live this
time. No, I'm never going to. You were absolutely right. And when you said, what the heck is that doing here? It just made us throw everything up in the air and think, whoa, we lost the plot.
But I think going for the open plan feel, when you stand here now and you see the two beautiful round windows there and the two beautiful windows at this side, it just breathes.
The planners have asked that the new extension be distinctly different from the old mill, so it's going to be clad in timber.
It's flying on, isn't it?
Absolutely.
It looks good.
They're making good progress with the new build, but at the back of the old mill, it's a different story.
I mean, when you look at something like that, and the condition of that building and the amount of earth that you've had to dig out. This is a kind of, you know, bordering on a kind of civil engineering job. Mm-hmm. It's like building a bridge or something like that. You're having to dig soil out, put concrete in, waterproof tank, make sure that you don't push this thing over. I'm amazed it didn't collapse 20 years ago, honestly.
What's great is that Alan and Dora have managed to sell their old house.
You've actually moved down
to here. Yeah.
They're renting close to site, and the sale has released the £175,000 they budgeted for the restoration. But as this has become an even more difficult project, I fear it may not be enough.
Do you mind me asking how much money you've spent so far on the build, if you know?
We've got
your best
running total. 115.
I mean, what is your limit in your head that you would become double spending on this building?
Two and a quarter sounds good to me. 225, 230 is probably... I'd really like to have it all wrapped up with little bows on the top for that.
That would be amazing. But
you
I
think
still
so?
Think that's going to be tough.
You think that's going to be tough?
Okay. Well, I just think if you're 115,000 in now and you're not windham watertight, if you have a full list of all the works that need to be done on this building, if I'm honest, you're probably not even a quarter of the way down that list, but you're okay. halfway through your budget.
I don't even want to think about kitchens or bathrooms or anything. I'll have a tin bath.
And a bucket.
Hello.
It's now November, and the race is on to make the mill wind and watertight so that they can get on with the interior works during the winter months. The first job is rebuilding the roof.
Obviously, this old roof had no underlayer, no sarking layer beneath the tiles, and no insulation at all. So the old tiles go off. We put insulation over the top, between, underneath, and then we'll put a new membrane on the top and the tiles back, and plasterboard on the underside.
If all goes well, they should be done before the bad weather starts. But with the long delays and the budget continuing to rise, they can't afford for anything else to go wrong. In Stone in Staffordshire, Alan and Dora Appleby are 14 months into the restoration of their 18th century flint mill. Spiralling costs have meant they're already £50,000 over their £175,000 budget. And now winter has struck, with only half a roof and no sign of the bespoke windows.
Morning.
Morning.
Good morning, George.
Happy New Year.
And a Happy New Year to you.
It's absolutely...
It is.
Bloody yeah. Freezing. Brass monkeys, I think, is the...
I know.
God, as I just drove through that archway with all the icicles up there and everything, I was like, it's
fantastic,
going to be a cold, cold day on site today.
Yeah.
And you're not wind and water tight.
The weather had the last word. You've got the usual UK construction break over Christmas, followed by snow, frost. And the guys have been really, really trying hard to get the roof finished and sorted, but they're just fighting against the elements at the moment.
But where are your windows? Are they not even here?
They can't release them because the paint hasn't cured properly and they don't want it to come out in the weather. So I suppose they're saying that the weather's holding them up.
It's a bit of a shame, actually, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's a real disappointment for me. Mr. Grumpy, Mr. Poor.
Mr. Poor and grumpy now.
You're even more grumpy than
I'm
you were before.
I'm more grumpy and much poorer.
These screams come from the office and you think, no!
I always thought their budget was optimistic. But the reality of how much this build is actually going to cost is beginning to hit home.
How's the money? Come on, be honest.
Well,
come on, you had your budget of
175. I was living in my little dream world. You just fool yourself into believing that you might possibly be able to do it. And I reckon we won't be far short of 2.5 by the time we've finished.
250,000.
I think there's only about 50 grand left.
Yeah.
Readily accessible.
Whoa. So you spent 200 grand?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Crikey.
Yeah, I know.
Look, you've only got 50 grand
we
left.
We don't do holidays much.
You're not going to do holidays for a while.
Well, we might end up with a mortgage. Big one. Didn't want one, but might end up one. So what?
We'll get it from
I'll keep working a bit longer.
Even that 50 grand might be tight. It might be close to a three. Sorry about that.
No, don't worry.
At least in the new extension, the windows have arrived and are in. And a dry interior means that they're able to get going with the studwork and plasterboarding. But I'm really interested to see what progress they've managed to make in the original building.
How's the ground floor coming on?
Quite well, actually. I'm pleased.
Oh, this has moved on, hasn't it?
This is coming on wonderfully.
That feels completely different in every shape and form. This is where you had the platform, that little platform.
That's right, that mezzanine floor. Yeah.
And this is the timber from that.
We're trying to put it back. The planners weren't particularly fussy about them keeping that. But Dora liked the fact that it gave her a sort of kitchen area underneath the mezzanine. And I felt it was part of the history, it was part of the garage use of this building. So let's try and hang on to it.
What will be the new kitchen has a new concrete floor, and Dora and Alan are determined that another relic from the garage years, the old vehicle inspection pit, won't be forgotten.
The inspection pit timbers...
Oh, look at that.
..have now been saved.
We've made it into a table.
Yeah. Which grubby, horrible things that we dragged out of the way.
Yeah.
Aren't they lovely?
That's beautiful.
Nice and simple.
It's really simple, actually, but it's that kind of tough, hard industrial look that this building deserves, doesn't it?
You've got to admire Alan and Dora's commitment to this restoration. Despite being £75,000 over budget, there's no sign of them slowing down or cutting corners. They've brought me to a local salvage yard to look at another piece of furniture they're having restored.
This is like going back in time, this place, isn't it?
It's just fantastic.
After you.
This is the big mama ship I've been saving for
They found this massive solid steel workbench in a local garage. It dates from the 1920s, and Dora wants to use it as her main kitchen unit.
This is how
we found it.
All knackered and rusted.
Yeah, with several layers of ghastly paint.
And that's all been rubbed down.
And this is, they're just starting to work on it just to see how it comes out.
That is fabulous. That is absolutely beautiful.
The bench cost them £80, but Alex Plant, who also created their inspection pit table, will spend 2 months grinding off the paint, sandblasting, and finally waxing it. After its restoration, they'll have a one-off piece of furniture, but it will have cost them around £1,000.
Comes up beautifully, though.
When you take it back, you can't replicate that look on a new piece.
That's all your patina, isn't it, and texture that it's got there. Even all the bits where it's been knocked and bashed a bit, it doesn't matter, really. It just adds to the character of it, I think. Yeah, I think it's amazing.
It does.
Alan and Dora have always been determined that their restoration of the mill will celebrate its industrial past. Every year, our mill and the others in the Muddleshaw Valley were sending 6,000 tonnes of ground flint on the 10-mile journey by canal to the potteries of Stoke-on-Trent. The heyday of the Staffordshire pottery industry is long since over, but Stoke is still a centre for ceramic production. I've come to meet Emma Bridgewater, whose designs sell all over the world, to ask her what prompted this mid-18th century demand for paler plates.
There was this raging craze for Chinese porcelain, imported at enormous cost, and that's got a lovely creamy white consistency. And the potters here, they wanted to be able to produce something like that. Suddenly, what was required was something much more refined and pale.
The man who really capitalised on this craze was Josiah Wedgwood, the great innovator of the Staffordshire pottery industry. He was committed to coming up with the perfect recipe of clay and ground flint. And in 1763, he launched creamware, a beautiful and affordable creamy white tableware, which immediately went into mass production.
Wedgwood had much bigger dreams, and what he wanted was to be able to compete with the Chinese. He wanted to sell to royalty and the great big growing population in London. He was really focused on that. He moved his showroom around the West End to be where it was all happening all the time. I really do think that creamware, that late 18th, early 19th century creamware, is some of the nicest stuff. It's potted like eggshell.
By the mid-19th century, most of the big factories had started grinding flint themselves, using steam-driven machinery. But in the early days of the boom, the Muddleshaw Valley would have been the main supplier, and I think I found some documents that tie our mill to this pivotal moment.
Now, this is a letter which was found in a house in Stone. Because we know that there's only one flint mill in Stone, this letter might be tied into our mill. It's to a guy called Robert Bill, and it's basically tipping him off about a fantastic, good quality shipment of flint. Does he want
Love it?
The other thing that I found, this is basically an in-book from, it seems to me like a middleman, a guy called Badley. He's bought ground up flint from Rob Bill. But the amazing leap is then his outbook. Oh. And his outbook is then supplying, whose name is that?
Is it Josiah, is it?
It is, it's Josiah.
My God, how exciting.
So our tiny little humble mill was a really important part of that supply chain.
Playing a crucial role.
150 years later, and they're still manufacturing cream earthenware in Stoke, but with one key difference. They've replaced flint with a chemical compound called sodium silica.
This is our 21st century flint.
Yes.
In effect. Oh, I mean, I shouldn't be so happy about that, because it means that our flint mill's completely redundant now forever and ever, isn't it?
Much of the process is still done by hand, following the same methods they would have used in Josiah Wedgwood's day. They make around 1 million pieces of cream earthenware in this factory every year. Our mill may no longer be in operation, but the product it helped create is still a big British success story.
So if you sound all the work, and that's a dud.
What does that mean?
It's cracked.
Ah. So what's the sound of a good one?
Rings.
Ah.
It's March, and finally there's some good news for Alan. His bespoke doors and windows have arrived.
Yes! We're done. We're in.
Being wind and watertight, even if you're 5 months behind schedule, is definitely an excuse for a party.
Straight through the roof. Oh no, look, structural faults.
Sadly, the celebrations are short-lived. Just before Easter, the bad weather returns and they're hit by the coldest spring for 50 years.
We'd plan to get the bank excavated on this west side to keep the dampness away from the mill. And then along come the blizzards and the snow again. So everybody's gone home, digger's gone. I don't know what I did in a previous life. But obviously this one's not running quite to plan.
The budget certainly isn't going to plan. In addition to the purchase price of £100,000, they've already spent around £250,000 on restoring the mill.
You get your frustrating days where you've had really, really bad weather, jobs can't get done. I am tired. We're both tired, we're both exhausted. I mean, you don't sleep the same because it's just this constant wheel going round in your head. I don't think we've had a really good night's sleep for a long time.
It's 18 months since I first came to the mill, and there's a huge push by everyone to finish this project.
That's cracking on, isn't it?
It is, man.
Flying on. Oh, that's all painted out on there.
Yep.
Which is all lovely.
Despite Alan's experience as a professional surveyor and restorer of old buildings, this one, it seems, has pushed him to the limit.
Ah, it's fantastic.
Heading in the right direction,
yeah,
George.
It's great. How bad has it been recently?
Anybody that's done a restoration project on a listed building will know that it will stretch you. It will stretch you to whatever your limit happens to be. There's been doors slammed and tears cried and, you know, heads scratched. And if you listen carefully, you can hear the sound of piggy banks smashing in the distance because we're raiding every penny we've got in every cupboard to finish this.
What's the money situation?
We're knocking towards 300.
Whoa! Yeah. 300 grand.
Yeah, yeah. We're dipping into resources that really should be reserved for feeding our retirement.
You're nearly there, mate.
Yes.
You'll be all right.
Despite being £125,000 over budget, the level of workmanship on this restoration hasn't been compromised. Today they're fitting the bespoke metal staircase, which will lead from the living room up to their bedroom.
Shall I go up? Thanks, mate. These are great rooms, aren't they? I love the way you've got the timbers all beautifully revealed and the bits of the little panels of plaster in between. Oh, fantastic. Oh, great, so you'll have a little balcony.
Yeah.
Be able to sit out there. But look at all this, all the retaining work you've done there.
Oh,
crikey.
Yes. 60 tonnes of rock.
I'm not surprised you've spent all your money. It's incredible, the commitment that Alan and Dora have made of this restoration project. It really has pushed them to the absolute limit. They've kind of hit rock bottom, really. On a positive note, they're kind of pushing to get to the end, and they can see light at the end of the tunnel now that decorating's happening and things like that. The bad side is the budget is completely out of control, and they're now throwing every single penny that they've got to try and get it finished.
It's 2 years since I first set eyes on the Flint Mill. Back then it was in a tragic state, unused and unloved, and on the verge of collapse. Now this historic relic of a bygone era has been saved and given a new lease of life as the home of Alan and Dora Appleby.
Debt collector.
Morning. Lovely to see you.
How are you? Are you well?
I'm well.
Morning.
God, you're nearly looking as smart as me.
Well, I do try occasionally. I've scrubbed up.
Unbelievable.
Hey. No longer knackered.
Can we go inside and have a look?
Yeah.
Can we?
Come on.
I'm a little bit too excited about this
guy. Are you good?
I've been waiting bloody 2 years.
What used to be the old wheelhouse has been transformed into a spacious hall with traditional lime wash on the walls.
This is looking very smart, isn't it? really nice attention to detail out there. You've just got it right, because it breathes, it works really well for the building, but it gives it a really fresh look, doesn't it?
When they started this restoration, the mill was one big open space. It's now been divided up, and a bright welcoming kitchen occupies the ground floor.
Oh, look at that home sweet home!
The old mezzanine level has been refurbished and is now a useful storage area.
What you've done with this space is just lovely. I mean, you think what it was like before. Let's say a kind of workshop.
Standing on the exact spot where the inspection pit used to be is the table made out of the old timbers. And the reconditioned steel workbench fits right in with its new role as a kitchen unit.
The kitchen. Look at that. What a beast of a kitchen that is. I just love the honesty with it all. I mean, you're running a bit of conduit down, you know, against the timber, putting a socket there, very functional, because you need that for all your kitchen prep. Mm. But it just works. That balance of the old with the new and the functional is brilliant, I think.
From being a single space, the mill has now been split into three levels.
Love the staircase.
Recycled again, recycled planks.
This is the bit I've been waiting for.
The stunning first floor living room is an open plan space, which allows you to appreciate the beauty of the original windows.
It really is a lovely room, isn't it?
We just wanted it simple, didn't we? We didn't want clutter.
I love the timbers. I mean, I always did. But to leave all of them in place and just leave them exposed.
Three days by hand with knife, scraper, hoover, brush. Mm. I even had to wear a special mask because there was a lot of silica dust, the flint dust, on them.
It was nearly a quarter of an inch thick.
The metal and timber staircase leads up to the attic, where they have a very quaint bathroom and master bedroom.
Mind your head, George.
I've got to crouch in there, haven't I? Look at that. Loft rooms. Rooms tucked right in at the top are my favourite rooms, really.
The sound is totally different in a roof room. And you can hear the wood expanding and cracking and weird sounds.
I mean, that's the thing with an old building like this, is it's just kind of breathing and twisting and moving a little bit all the time. And it'll just settle after a while. Because if you think about it, this building's been knocked about a bit by you guys to save it.
There is no doubt that the old mill has been saved, and the new extension complements it perfectly. Leading off the hall on the ground floor, there's a bright functional office. Above it on the first floor is an elegant and spacious guest bedroom. Outside, where a muddy bank once threatened to push the old mill over, there's an attractive terraced garden. The old brick water channel that was uncovered during the build has been turfed over with a lush green lawn that marks the path the water would have taken. There was never any doubt that Alan and Dora were going to do a fantastic job with this restoration, but at what cost? The budget has dogged this build from the start.
How much did you spend in the end?
Well, if I said that my original...
Tell the truth, come on.
My original contingency was 10%. I forgot a naught. It should have been 100%.
100% contingency? 175 to 350.
Correct.
I mean, double the cost. Yeah. You've had to find another 175,000 quid.
Yeah. We may have ended up with a better house, but we still had to find that money, and that was a struggle. Mentally, physically and financially exhausted. The tank is empty. Mm. But we've done it. Mm. We've done it, we've made it.
Determined to stay mortgage-free, Alan and Dora were forced to raid their pension pot to find the last £50,000 to finish the work. Including the purchase price, the mill has cost them an eye-watering £450,000. For the past 2 years, everything has taken second place to the restoration. So to celebrate the end of this truly mammoth project, they're joined by family and friends for a housewarming.
bear gifts.
Oh, fabulous.
Can you remember that?
Yes.
Looking all sad and neglected. Mm. And then...
Josiah.
Wedgwood.
Oh, Josiah Wedgwood, yeah.
Lift the top off that. I've had this.
Oh, my Lord.
I've had this specially made for
him. Oh, my God.
A great British present to congratulate Alan and Dora on breathing new life in the Stone's historic flint mill. Handmade by Emma Bridgewater and George Clark.
I know.
You did it. Fantastic. Big round of applause.
Thank you, George.
Jesus, good.
It must be really difficult for someone like Alan, a professional building surveyor, to take on a project like this. Why? Because when you're seduced by such a beautiful but derelict building like this was, your heart begins to overrule your head. You fall in love with the building so much, you may as well throw the rule book out of the window. And that's why Alan and Dora went so massively over budget. Has it been worth it? Absolutely. Because without people like them, beautiful buildings like this wouldn't survive. To collect information and inspiration from the show in your own online scrapbook, or if you have a project you'd like to be featured in the next series, go to channel4.com/George. Next time, I meet a couple restoring a church beset with problems.
I challenge anybody to do this without it impacting your life.
And it could ultimately tear them apart.
I'm shocked by how deep you have to go, and you've only got to go a bit further, and you can literally be over the edge.
More next Wednesday at 8. Get your skates on and catch up on Speed with Guy Martin, now available for your viewing pleasure on 4OD. It's Red Nose Day, but not everything's a laugh. 24 Hours in A&E is back next.